in this place. And I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know they feel the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. Without a doubt, we'll know that you have been revived when we shall leave this place. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place.
St. John's, what a delight it is to be here this morning. What a wonderful delight it is to see each and every one of you as we've gathered in this place for worship. Let's give glory to the Lord our God. Friends, we have a lot of exciting things coming up. Before I get into the announcements, though, I want to first invite you, if you're sitting at the end of the aisle, to take a minute, take the friendship pad, fill that out, and pass that on down. Friendship pad is one of the ways we get to know who is attending Sunday morning and one of the tools we utilize to connect back with you, to get you plugged into all the exciting things we have coming up. And it's also one of the ways not only we get to know who you are, but how we can reach out to you. And I'm delighted to say at the end of the announcements, we're going to be receiving new members here at this service this morning. And I just wanted to make this brief announcement. If you have been attending St. John's for a while, if you are wanting to get more committed, more plugged in, more involved, and you want to make St. John's your home, this is your home church, please feel free to reach out to us, myself or Julie Davis, our Director of New Members Outreach, and we would love to hear from you. We could get it set up to where you can meet with myself and the other pastors, get to see the church, and we would love to hear from you and have that conversation. So keep that in mind if that's something that you've been pondering, and we would love to be a contact for you to make that happen. First thing I want to mention is that we are going to be having our monthly healing service right after this service at 10 o'clock in the church chapel. Holy Communion, prayer, and anointing with oil will take place during this service, and all in need of prayer are welcome to come and attend. We especially invite you, if you haven't seen it before, please check out the healing service. We also want to make mention that our evening vesper service will be held tonight at 6 p.m., our monthly evening vesper service. It will be also in the chapel, and Holy Communion will be celebrated there as well. We're excited because this upcoming week is our Missions Impact Celebration Week. We're going to have a number of events that are going to be highlighting our international mission partners and celebrating what St. John's is doing to make a missional impact in the world. We want to mention that Wednesday night is going to be our kickoff for the Missions Impact Celebration. It will start with a missions supper that will take place here in the Faith Center at 6 o'clock. Since this is being hosted by our missions leadership team, there will be no charge for food, but donations will be accepted to help fund an upcoming Honduras trip that our youth are going to be attending this upcoming April. So we encourage you to come and attend. We ask that you sign up so that we have a count for the meal, and you can do so by calling the church office. We ask that you do that by tomorrow, by 4 o'clock. But there will be no takeout meals that will be served this week. But we will be having a meal here at the church to be celebrating our kickoff for missions leadership, MIC. And additionally, another event we're going to have in light of MIC is this upcoming Saturday. We will be having a pancake breakfast here at 9 o'clock that will take place to celebrate our international mission partners. We're going to hear from some of them both in person and through video. We're going to be doing a Q&A to get to know some of the partners that we're funding. And please note that there is a QR code in the bulletin that you can scan to register for that. And you can also register for the Saturday morning breakfast by calling the church office as well. There are a number of other announcements in the bulletin today, so please take a look at that and see everything that we have coming up. But at this time, I would like to invite the Evans family to come forward, Brett and Lisa Evans to come forward. Once again, this is an exciting part of our church, is to see people who are coming, attending, but to see St. John's as a home church, a place where you are covenanting with the church, and the church is doing the same for you, to see everything that we do as a church family, and we are delighted to have you here. So, Brett and Lisa, I ask you, in the presence of this congregation, do you swear to uphold this church by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Well, we are delighted to receive you. Thank you so much. Let's give them a hand. And let me, want to give you these. In our new members bag, we always have information that has information about our programs, about the events that we have coming up, questions about the United Methodist Church, all sorts of goodies, and we want to make sure that everybody who comes knows everything that we do as a part of the church and what you can do to be a part of it all. So we are delighted to have you. Now, friends, let us stand and let us continue our worship this morning.
Like we're in the dead of winter, waiting on something better. But am I really gonna hide forever? Over, over again, I hear your voice in my head. Let your light shine, let your light shine for all to see. Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying. Let it burn so brightly that everyone around can see that it's you that we need. Start a fire in me. Ooh, 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 ooh. It only takes fire to start a whole blaze. It only takes a little faith. Let it start right here in this city, so these old walls will never be the same. Over and over again, I hear your voice in my head. They need to know, I need to go. Spirit, won't you fall on my heart now? Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying. Let it burn so brightly that everyone around can see that it's you. You are the flame, you are the light on the darkest day. We have the hope, we bear your name. We carry the news that you have come to say. Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying. Let it burn so brightly that everyone around can see that it's you that we need. Start a fire in me. Ooh, 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 ooh. Start a fire in me.
Friends, I invite you to remain standing as together we affirm our faith with the words of the song, We Believe. Now, friends, let us go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord God, this morning we lift our eyes upon you. We seek you. We incline our hearts to hear your voice. As the psalmist wrote, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. And Lord, may we not forget that. You are our creator, you are our redeemer, you are the one who brings us strength and who calls forth each day, who gives us our calling to seek you and to be your hands and feet in this world. Lord, we have gathered as your people, as your church this morning to worship you and to be reminded of your faithfulness, of the peace and the fulfillment that you give to us through Jesus. This day and every day, Lord, we praise you. And this day and every day, we remember that you are faithful. Even when we are not, you continue to seek us. Lord, we seek to live in obedience for you, but we stumble and we fall. But great is your faithfulness. Great is the forgiveness that you offer to us through your Son, Jesus. How grand is your mercy. And because of that, Lord, we ask that you would lead us, that Holy Spirit, you would descend on us and fill our hearts so that we may be molded into the image of Christ, that we may seek to live for him always, that we would be bold and courageous this day for the sake of the gospel. And it is in that hope that we come to you with confidence and assurance, and we know that you hear our voice. These things we ask and we affirm together as your church and as your people. As together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now I'd like to invite Heather to come forward.
Good morning. This month, the children have been learning the song 10,000 Reasons in Sunday School. So I'm going to invite all my friends to come forward, and we are just going to worship with you. We have learned a little bit of sign language to go with the chorus, and we hope you enjoy hearing us sing. And we thank Miss Jane and the band for playing the song for us this morning.
And if It is time for our offering, so if we will please give back as the good Lord has given us. This is our offering song.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, and sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. You're great, your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever.
Yeah, let me scoot right here between you, and then we're going to, Heather, why don't we sing that other song too in a minute? Okay. Well, today we're going to talk about how we are the light of the world. Jesus, in this passage of Scripture that I'm going to speak from in just a little bit, says, you are the light of the world, and he's talking about us. And when I was a child, we learned a song about that. And it's called This Little Light of Mine. How many of you know the song, This Little Light of Mine? Do you know it? Do you know it? Good job. All right, let's look this way, buddy. Oh, why not? Okay, so let me give you something to help you, okay? There's a little button on the bottom. Well, every now and then there's one that's not working. There you go. So we're going to be the light of the world. Let's see. Boom. Boom. You got one? Okay. Here, Annie. There you go. You got it? Everybody got one? Well, you don't want to be a light that's not working, right? Okay. We good? There we go. There you go. All right. So, Miss Heather, I'm not going to sing because I don't want to ruin this.
Let it shine. This little light of mine.
All right. I brought with me another kind of light as well. This is one that I sometimes take camping with me, or when I'm working on something like under the sink and I need a light and I need my hands to work right. So I don't want anything to mess up, and so I'll do a different kind of light, and let's see, another kind of light, and red, more, and it'll even start flashing if I'm in trouble. So it comes in handy. So here's the point. We've got all kinds of lights. We've got these battery-operated lights. We've got these hands-free lights called headlamps that we can put on our head that can help us out, especially when we're camping or when we're outside or when we need to use our hands and we don't need to hold a flashlight in one hand, we need to use both our hands. God uses all of us, no matter who we are, no matter how we let our light shine, if we will shine for Jesus, no matter who we are, what our different gifts are, some of us are better at speaking, some of us are better at listening, some of us are better at doing things with our hands. Some of us are great at drawing things. How many of you are good at drawing things? You do great. So there are all kinds of ways to let our light shine for Jesus so we can help people around us in the world. So I want you to do that. Use your voices, use your singing, use your drawing, use your listening, use your mouths, use all the different ways God has given you light so that you can help other people see. Okay? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we pray that you will help us to so let our light shine before people that they may see our good deeds, but that they might glorify you in heaven. So, Lord, that is our prayer. Thank you for these children. Thank you for the ways that they let your light shine. Oh, Lord, please shine through us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You can go back now to your seats. Thank you. Thank you, Heather. Oh, you can keep them.
Oh, awesome.
Go. Anybody need another one? Why not? Okay, right. Why not? Our scripture lesson this morning is from Matthew's Gospel, the 5th chapter, starting at verse 13. Starting at verse 13. Jesus is speaking. He says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, So let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Indeed. Euphemisms. That's an interesting word when we talk about euphemisms. Anytime you see the word EU or the letters EU in front of a word, it means good. A eulogy is a good word about somebody when you think about their death and resurrection. A euphemism means a good saying. Phemismo is the Greek word for saying. And so a good saying, a euphemism, is a way to say something in a nice way that might otherwise come out in a way that might be a bit negative. I don't know about you, but sometimes it's very easy for me to just jump to it and say the negative rather than use a euphemism, to use something that softens the blow a little bit and makes it come out a little bit nicer. For instance, we might say about somebody who's smart that they're bright, right? And we might say about somebody who's not so smart that they're not too bright. Those are euphemisms. Well, in this passage of Scripture, Jesus uses two euphemisms. He says, you are the salt of the earth, and you are the light of the world. You might think of a euphemism like an analogy or a metaphor, but these two euphemisms we understand. Why do we understand them? Well, if you like salt as much as I do, even though my doctor says to cut back on it because of high blood pressure and those kinds of things like that, you know if we are to be the salt of the earth, that is a euphemism, that is an analogy, that is a metaphor that means that we are supposed to flavor this world for Jesus. If you've ever eaten anything and you're used to having salt on your vegetables or salt on your food, and you've had to eat it and it hasn't got salt on it, how does it taste? Bland. I mean, it tastes worse than bland. It's almost, for those of us who really like salt, it's almost inedible. I want my salt. So, as my dear wife and my mother used to say, you can always add more salt, but you can't take it away. And so Cindy, very often, she cooks food and it has zero salt in it. So what do I do? Because I'm so used to that, I automatically, before I go to the table to have lunch or dinner or whatever the case may be, I go pick up the salt shaker to take it with me. And I get that look. You haven't even tasted it yet. Sometimes I get that phrase. You haven't even, but I know you. After 47 years of marriage, I know that you haven't put any salt in it. Sometimes when we look at our world, it doesn't look like Jesus has been around that much either. We have not been flavoring the world as Christians. And then he says this other euphemism, this other analogy, this other metaphor, that we are to be the light of the world. Now, what good does light do? It comes in handy when you are working on something. It comes in handy, for instance, at night. If you have a night light, it provides some security. It helps keep you from running into things. It keeps you from stubbing your toe. Light dispels the darkness. Light makes darkness go away. And in this world of ours, we see a lot of darkness, and so we wonder sometimes whether or not we have been the light of the world. So we're to be the salt of the earth, and we're to be the light of the world. The question arises, how good are we at doing that? How good are we at doing that? Some of you might remember in your history classes, you learned about how the old days of when railroads first started coming on the scene, and that's how Aiken, for instance, got started, was the railroad from Charleston to North Augusta, or basically a little village called Hamburg. And railroads were very important. And in the early days of railroading, they didn't have these electronic guards, these pieces of wood that would come down and would block traffic. They had actual living crossing guards, railroad crossing guards, people who would carry a lantern, and if they heard a train coming or some kind of public conveyance coming, it was their job to have their lantern and to put it out and to warn people that a train was coming so there wouldn't be a big crash and people get hurt. Well, this one crossing guard fell asleep one night. He didn't hear the train coming. He didn't hear the public transportation conveyance coming, and so he woke up with a start when he finally figured it out that a train was coming, and he ran outside with his lantern in his hand, but it was too late. A crash occurred, and there was a lot of loss of life. It was terrible, and so they put him on trial for negligence. They put him on trial for negligence, this crossing guard. And they asked him two questions. Were you present when the accident occurred? And he said, yes, I was present when the accident occurred. He was outside. He wasn't asleep in the guardhouse. He was outside, this crossing guard. And then they asked him the second question, did you have your lantern in your hand? And he said, yes, I had my lantern in my hand. And they said, you're innocent. He was exonerated. But his conscience got the best of him because he knew there was one thing they didn't ask. So he confessed. And they said, well, why are you guilty? We asked if you were present, and you said yes. We asked if you had your lantern in your hand, and you said yes. And then he interrupted them and said, but you didn't ask me whether or not the lantern was lit. It wasn't. So it was his fault. And so he confessed. How lit is our lantern? Is our lantern brightly shining to the people around us? You know, we heard the children sing, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, no, I'm going to let it shine. Don't let Satan blow it out, I'm going to let it shine. We know that song, this little light of mine. Most of us have learned that at Bible school or Sunday school or somewhere along the way. And we've heard all the verses, and we know all the verses. But I'm afraid sometimes that we're not like those little candles or flashlights or headlamps or whatever means of light that we're supposed to use or could use. Instead, we more often than not like the song, Shine on Me. I don't know if you remember the song, Shine on Me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Lord, the light of your love is shining. Shine on me. Shine on me. There's a difference between those two songs. Between Shine on Me and This Little Light of Mine. This Little Light of Mine is all about giving light. That we are to be reflectors of God's love into this crazy dark world that we live in. Whereas, on the other hand, the song Shine on Me is about shining on me. It's like the difference between being a reflector and being a solar charger, a solar charger that hoards the light, that hoards the power, that stores the power, but doesn't give it necessarily. I mean, what good is a solar charger that if you charge it up and you never plugged in your iPhone to it, or if you never used it to supply power? God wants us to use our light and not absorb light and never give it. We're not to be solar panels. We are to be reflectors. I don't know if you watched last night's news, but it made me think of the passage of Scripture from Revelation chapter 14, verse 13, which says, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from henceforth, that they may rest from their labors, but their good deeds follow after them. Last night on the evening news, I'm not going to tell you the channel, there was a news bit about a guy named Hody, H-O-D-Y, Hody Buford, from Geraldine, Alabama, Hody Buford. some years ago, I'm talking about a long time ago, Hody Buford decided that he had some extra money, and he knew that there was only one drugstore in Little Geraldine, Alabama, and that he should do what he could to help people who could not afford their medicines. So every month, month in, month out, he would take a $100 bill and give it to the pharmacist at the drugstore in Geraldine, Alabama, and they would use that money to help people who could not afford their medicines. Last night, it was on the national news, and some of you saw that. And now his daughter is continuing this because he died on New Year's Day. It's a message about how we're to let our light shine and make a difference in the world. It is what it says in Revelation chapter 14, "Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, yes, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, but their good works do follow after them." It's a reminder of what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. "So let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father who is in heaven." The Cokesbury hymnal that we used in my first parish. I had three little churches for 5 years, Mount Olivet, Pleasant Grove, and Bethesda. And we sang out of the Cokesbury songbook, the Cokesbury hymnal, number 97. "Brightly beams your Father's mercy. Brightly beams our Father's mercy." And it's got the refrain that goes like this: "Let the lower lights be burning. Send a gleam across the wave. Some poor fainting, struggling seaman you may rescue, you may save." How many of you remember that old song? Some of you, I see some hands out there. It's a beautiful old song. You can Google it and listen to it. "Let the lower lights be gleaming. Send a gleam across the wave. Some poor fainting, struggling seaman you may rescue, you may save." We know that the great light, the lighthouse, is Jesus. But the lower lights are the lights that are at water level to help guide ships after they've been warned by the great lighthouse to beware the rocks. The lower lights are lit so as to help ships make their way safely into the harbor. We are the lower lights. We are the ones who are to shine our lights. Jesus is the lighthouse. We are the lower lights. How brightly is our light shining to direct people safely into the harbor of Jesus? In this world in which we live, I'm afraid there are a lot of people stumbling around in the dark, and they're crashing against the rocks, and they're not making it safely into the harbor because we're not shining our light well enough. You know, I've heard some humor about how many different people, what's the number of people it takes, of different groups of people, to change a light bulb. I think we've all heard some of those funny stories. But you can alternate any of these names. I will say one. For instance, how many Amish does it take to change a light bulb? And the answer is easy, zero, because they don't use light bulbs. But then on the other hand, some other Christian groups, they might say, how many people does it take to change a light bulb? And it might be zero as well, not just the Amish, because what change? My grandmother gave that light bulb, some might say. One denomination said that it takes at least 109 of their members to change a light bulb. It takes one to change the light bulb. It takes 100 to serve on different committees to figure out who's going to supply the next light bulb and which person that they should buy it from, and then 8 to bring the fried chicken and the potato salad. And then there's an even more humorous, but sadly humorous, story about how many Methodists it takes to change a light bulb. Our Council of Bishops has issued a statement, and this is what it says: "We choose not to make a statement either in favor of or against the need for a light bulb. However, if in your own spiritual journey you have found that a light bulb works for you, that is fine. You are invited to write a poem or compose a modern dance about your personal relationship with your light bulb and present it next month at our annual Light Bulb Sunday service. in which we will explore a number of light bulb traditions, including incandescent, fluorescent, three-way, long life, tinted, and Alexa and Siri-controlled light bulbs, all of which are equally valid paths to luminescence. Now, folks, I don't know about you all, but I find that to be quite sad. Now, our bishop here in South Carolina, Bishop Jonathan Holston, is orthodox, traditional. He is as sharp as they can come. He's a good guy. He's a good guy. But not all of the Council of Bishops do I feel that same way about, because of the ambiguity that exists in our denomination right now about what we believe and what we don't believe and how we're going to act and how we're not going to act in terms of behaviors. So I think we live in a day and age when we need to really pay attention to what Jesus is saying in this passage of Scripture, that we are to be the salt of the earth and we are to be the light of the world. Now that is important. The church cannot be the salt of the earth if it sugarcoats the truth. Listen to me. The church cannot be the salt of the earth if it sugarcoats the truth, and neither can we be the light of the world if we put a dimmer switch on Jesus. We have got to be filled with truth, and we've got to speak the truth in love. We've got to speak the truth in love and love everybody and welcome everybody. But at the same time, if we don't stand up for something, we're going to fall for anything. So we need light to keep us from stumbling around in the dark. I used to enjoy listening to Jerry Clower, the country comedian. I saw him in, I don't know if you call it concert or whatever, but he was at Carolina Coliseum in Columbia, and it was joyful. He would talk about Marcel and his talking chainsaw, but I liked it especially when he talked about his uncle Versi Leadbetter. When he talked about his uncle Versi Leadbetter, he said that Uncle Versi went to a deacon's meeting at the church one night, and at the deacon's meeting, one person made a motion that the church would buy a chandelier. And somebody else seconded the motion to buy a chandelier. And Uncle Versi said, "Boys, you can make a motion to buy a chandelier. You can vote on it to buy the chandelier. But I'm going to tell you this. We don't have enough people with education around here to be able to even spell chandelier. And I don't think we've got anybody who knows how to play one. What we really need in this place is more light." And the same is true about our society, about our lives, about our world. There is so much ambiguity. There's so much confusion. There's just so much darkness. I want you to pray for us this week. I say us, I'm looking at Dean Willis right here, and there's some others in here. We're going to be at Trenton Correctional Institution all this week, starting Tuesday, but we're meeting tomorrow. And some of the people are going to be going to Trenton Correctional Institution, the prison in Trenton, to go through orientation tomorrow afternoon. I've already been through that orientation. But we're going to be there all week to try to bring light into the darkness, to bring light into the darkness. So we covet your prayers. We need your prayers, but not just for us, but mainly for the residents of the prison, so that we will make a difference and they will be changed. South Carolina has the lowest recidivism rate of any state in the United States. In many ways, South Carolina is always at the bottom of everything. But the one thing that we're on top is that we have the least number of prisoners who end up going back to prison. And some wardens, and this is why this will be Trenton Kairos number one, some wardens have figured out that one of the main reasons why South Carolina has fewer people going back to prison once they've been to prison is because they have found Jesus. They have found Jesus. So we're going in there this week. So we need your prayers. We need your prayers. They need your prayers. They need your prayers. Indeed, Jesus has said that we're to be the salt of the earth, the light of the world. To be the salt of the earth and light of the world, and the church cannot be the salt of the earth if it sugarcoats the truth, and we cannot be the light of the world if we put a dimmer switch on Jesus. We need Jesus shining brightly this week. We need Jesus shining brightly in our lives, not just at Trenton Correctional Institution. Of course, you just heard me call it Trenton with a T in the middle of it when it's really Trenton, Trenton Correctional Institution. For those of you who know Trenton or who are from Trenton, we need to let our light shine. Let me tell you a story about how that helps everybody when we let our light shine, when we do good for others and our Father in heaven is glorified. There was this guy named Bill who was out of work. He was taking day jobs in the upper Midwest, and he had this old white Pontiac that was beat up and about to break down, but he was coming back home one night after working all day at a sawmill, because he would just take a job whenever he would get a phone call that they needed somebody to come to work. And he was trying to make as much money as he could because he and his wife are going to have a baby, and he just needed to take care of his family. And as he was driving home in his old white clunker Pontiac, he sees on the side of the road this lady in this Mercedes, and she's standing outside in the rain getting wet, and her car is broken down. Now, he pulls up in his old Pontiac, and she looks like she's afraid, which she should be afraid. I mean, it's always good to be safe. But she knew she needed help, and she'd been standing out in the rain for 35 minutes, and nobody had stopped to help her. But Bill stops to help her, and Bill says, "Ma'am, what seems to be the trouble? And don't worry, ma'am." He could see the look on her face. "I'm here to help you." And she pointed at her flat tire. And he said to her, "Ma'am," she was an older lady, "why don't you get back in the car where you'll be dry and safe and warm on this cold night?" And so she got back in the car. He got underneath the car, and he looked as best he could to try to find a place where he could get the jack to attach and it'd be safe attaching to the undercarriage. He wrapped his knuckles as he did that and skinned them a time or two. But finally, he was able to get everything set up and get the tire out of the trunk and get the tire changed. And just about the time he was finished, the lady let her window down and she said to him, "How much do I owe you?" And he said, "Ma'am, my daddy always said, Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, 'So let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father who is in heaven.' Ma'am, the way I want you to thank me is not by any money. You don't owe me anything. I want you to let the light keep shining. And whenever you see somebody in need, I want you to help them, and I want you to think of me." And she said, "I can do that." And so she took off in her Mercedes on her way to St. Louis, and he went toward his house. Well, she saw a cafe a couple miles down the road and decided that she wanted to get a bite to eat, maybe a cup of coffee, maybe dry off a little bit. And so she went inside this cafe, had two old gas pumps outside. It was kind of a rundown-looking place. It was not exactly clean. It looked like the cash register in that place rang about as much as an out-of-work actor's phone would ring. Not very often. But nevertheless, she went in and she sat down, and this sweet waitress came over to her. She had a smile on her face, even though she'd been on her feet all day, and this waitress looked like the most kind person in the world, and even proved it because she brought a clean towel and handed it to the lady so she could dry her hair that was still wet from the rain that had fallen on it. The waitress brought her her food. It was okay. It wasn't what she was used to and all of her finery, but nevertheless, she enjoyed the food, and she couldn't help but notice how kind and sweet that waitress was. She noticed as well that she looked like she was about 8 months pregnant. And she thought to herself, "You know, I ought to do something to help her out." And she remembered Bill. She remembered Bill, who had helped her out. And so she gave the waitress a $100 bill to pay for her tab, to pay for her bill. And when the waitress went over to the cash register. By the time she turned around, the lady was gone. She went back over to the table, and she saw four $100 bills sitting on top of the table and a note. And the note said, "You don't owe me anything except don't let the light stop with you. Don't let the love change stop with you. I was once in need and somebody helped me, and they told me that if I ever saw somebody in need, I should help them and remember him. I want you to do the same thing so that the light keeps going." And so she thought, wow, this has been the best day in a long time. We've been worried about how we're going to afford the baby. We've been worried about how we're going to afford diapers. We've been worried about how we're going to afford everything. We didn't know what to do. She put the money in her pocket. She finished filling up the sugar and sweet and low and so forth, dispensers, the little trays for those. She reloaded the napkins and the napkin holder. She did everything she needed to do to be ready for the next day, and then she went home. She crawled into bed, and her husband was already there, and she kissed him on the cheek, and she whispered in his ear, "Everything's going to be all right. I love you, Bill. I love you, Bill." What goes around comes around, doesn't it? In many, many ways. So don't let the light stop with you. Let the lower lights be burning. Send a gleam across the wave. Some poor, fainting, struggling seaman you may rescue, you may save. Amen. And now I'd like to invite the children to go to Sunday school and enjoy it. And be back tonight, all of you, with children, because children's program and our youth programming is tonight as well. Now I'd like to invite you to stand.
For your glory. Oh. all of this for your glory. All of this for your glory. All of this for your glory. All of this for your glory.
No longer I who live, Jesus lives in me.
Thanks, guys. Now may the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you. May the Lord so fill you with light that you reflect His light all around you. May your week be a glorious week. May it be filled with light and love. Amen. Amen.
All of this for your glory. 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 All of this for your glory.
No longer I who live, Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light. No longer
morning. Remember, tonight is our children's ministry. Sign in. It's 4:45 to 5 o'clock, and it's from 5 to 6:30. And we have youth tonight. So please make sure everybody is here weekend. Thank you.